It all began in 1971 in Palo Alto, just south of San Francisco, when Xerox, the copier company, set up the Palo Alto Research Center, or PARC. Xerox management had a sinking feeling that if people started reading computer screens instead of paper, Xerox was in trouble. Unless they could dominate the paperless office of the future.
In our research, we have found that technology is changing markets at a rate that has never been seen before. When we look at autonomous and networked cars, the calculations we run say that energy demand for transportation could be reduced by as much as 60 to 80%. These have dramatic effects on the future of energy markets. It also creates tremendous opportunities. We at Vantage not only look at the past, but we look at the future. And we will help you to build that bridge in a way you never thought possible.
But the brilliant researchers at PARC could never persuade Xerox management that their vision was accurate. Head office in New York ignored the revolutionary technologies they owned 3,000 miles away. They just didn't get it. But a few miles down the road from Palo Alto was a man ready to share the vision.
The most dangerous man in Silicon Valley sits in an office in this building. People love him and hate him, often at the same time. For 10 years, by sheer force of will, he made the personal computer industry follow his direction. With this guy, we're not talking about someone driven by the profit motive and a desire for an opulent retirement at the age of 40. No, we're talking holy war. We're talking rivers of blood and fields of dead martyrs to the cause of greater computing. We're talking about a guy who sees the personal computer as his tool for changing the world. We're talking about Steve Jobs.
I'm Steve Jobs.
When I wasn't sure what the word charisma meant, I met Steve Jobs, and then I knew.
Steve Jobs is on my eternal heroes list. There's nothing he can ever do to get off it.
He wanted you to be great. And he wanted you to create something that was great. And he was going to make you do that.
He's also obnoxious, and this comes from his high standards. He has extremely high standards, and he has no patience with people who don't either share those standards or perform to them.
And I'm also one of these people that I don't really care about being right, you know. I just care about success.
Steve Jobs had co-founded Apple Computer in 1976. The first popular personal computer, the Apple II, was a hit and made Steve Jobs one of the biggest names in a brand new industry. At the height of Apple's early success in December 1979, Jobs, then all of 24, had a privileged invitation to visit Xerox PARC.
And they showed me really three things. But I was so blinded by the first one that I didn't even really see the other two. One of the things they showed me was object-oriented programming. They showed me that, but I didn't even see that. The other one they showed me was really a networked computer system. They had over 100 Alto computers, all networked, using email, et cetera, et cetera. I didn't even see that. I was so blinded by the first thing they showed me, which was the graphical user interface. I thought it was the best thing I had ever seen in my life. Now, remember, it was very flawed. What we saw was incomplete. They'd done a bunch of things wrong, but we didn't know that at the time. It's still, though, they had the germ of the idea was there, and they'd done it very well. And within, you know, 10 minutes, it was obvious to me that all computers would work like this someday.
It was a turning point. Jobs decided this was the way forward for Apple.
He came back and I almost said asked, but the truth is demanded that his entire programming team get a demo of the Smalltalk system. And the then head of the Science Center asked me to give the demo because Steve specifically asked for me to give the demo. And I said, no way. I had a big argument with the Xerox executives, telling them that they were about to give away the kitchen sink. And I said I would only do it if I were ordered to do it, because then it, of course, would be their responsibility. And that's what they did.
The mouse is a pointing device that moves a cursor around the display screen.
Adele and her colleagues showed the Apple programmers an Alto machine running a graphical user interface.
A selected window displays above other windows, much like placing a piece of paper on top of a stack on a desk.
The visitors from Apple saw a computer that was designed to be easy to use, a machine that anybody could operate and find friendly, even the French.
Choose one.
I think mostly what we got in that hour and a half was inspiration, and basically just sort of a bolstering of our convictions that a more graphical way to do things would make this business computer more accessible.
After an hour looking at demos, they understood our technology and what it meant more than any Xerox executive understood it after years of showing it to them.
Basically, they were copier heads that just had no clue about a computer or what it could do. And so they just grabbed defeat from the greatest victory in the computer industry. Xerox could have owned the entire computer industry today. Could have been, you know, a company 10 times its size. Could have been IBM. Could have been the IBM of the 90s. Could have been the Microsoft of the 90s.